With the start of the new year, everyone is setting goals and making resolutions to get back in shape and become more productive now that the holiday season has passed. Well, our guest today is a former trainer for Tony Robbins and actually just lost 100 pounds himself. He's going to tell you why transforming your physical appearance isn't just a way to feel better about yourself, but can actually help lead to your financial success. Stay tuned. You do not want to miss today's episode.
Welcome to this edition of Peak Performers Podcast with your host, Thor Conklin. Thor will be sharing the necessary tools, strategies, and psychology you'll need to become a peak performer in any area of your life or business.
Thor Conklin here. We give you the tricks, the tips, the tools, the strategy, the technology, and the psychology peak performers use in order to get more done and execute at the highest level. If you know what to do but struggle with getting it all done, or simply want to raise your game to the next level, this podcast is for you. Sit back and enjoy.
Today's guest is Joe Williams, internationally known speaker, strategic expert, and former personal trainer to Tony Robbins. Joe specializes in electrifying audiences and moving them to take action. Joe has also trained 300,000 people at his speaker's bootcamp and helped his clients create over $50 billion in new business. If you want some tips, tricks, or tools in getting back into shape or learning how to be a more effective communicator, then sit back and listen to Joe. He is going to bring a value-packed episode.
Joe Williams, thank you very much for joining us today. You have the distinction of being the only person to this point that has been back on the show for another go at it.
Oh, wow. Lucky me, huh?
Well,
hopefully that's a good sign. Hopefully that's a great sign.
So, well, you know,
thanks for having me.
Oh, please. I mean, first of all, you have been one of the top rated shows. And I'll prove why. Well, I'll tell the audience why you're back on. I was going back to all the old episodes and I picked out the top five, the most popular, and I decided to have it transcribed. And the transcription service called me back and said, "Hey, Thor, where's part three of Joe Williams?" I said, "Well, it's on the website. Look for it." I was like, "Oh, you know, I hired the wrong transcriptionist, right?" So I go back to look for your part three, the part that you let the audience know how to get a hold of you, you know, kind of a whole wrap of the interview. It's gone. It doesn't exist.
Well, there you go. There you go. So there's a divine reason for me being back on then.
Exactly. And you know, it's kind of interesting because I think you were kind of episode number 20 or 15. I mean, it's really, really in the beginning.
It was.
Yeah. So the audience was small. We're coming up on 500 episodes now.
Wow. Congratulations.
Thank you. Thank you. It's crazy. So for everyone that did miss the original interview, and of course, everyone that missed part three, this is going to be Joe Williams part two. And we're going to fill back in some of the stuff that we talked about during that interview as well and dive into some new stuff. So I know you got a lot going on. So bring the audience up to speed. Here you are, 26 years old. You've started 12 companies over your lifetime as of right now. In 1996, you take your first company public at age 26. Dude, tell us about that.
Well, first of all, you just said it. It was 1996. I mean, that was really the front end of the golden time, you know, as many people of that age will recall, of the beginnings of, you know, the tech boom. And, you know, we went public, as I recall, right around the same time, you know, as Netscape blew up, which was really on kind of the front end of that. We were in a similar business. We were in telecom, which in those days was good old fashioned long distance service and, you know, wireless cellular reselling and paging and all of that. So we were, you know, there were a lot of young people who were the rock star CEOs in those days, or founders really is a better way to put it, for a lot of those companies. And I had some of that wind at my back. And so I will not shy away from admitting the fact that I was kind of right time, right place, and right industry. And even though all of that happened, and you know, all the good luck stories that could go along with that, I quickly, as in within about 60 days of really going hardcore public and meetings with board of directors and everything else that I did not anticipate, I realized, wow, I'd made a giant mistake. I was an entrepreneur at heart. I was all about starting things, bootstrapping them, getting them up and rolling, and then handing them off. And this was no different. I was not cut out to sit in an office 8, 10, 12, 14, 18 hours a day and manage pieces that I really did not have the skill set nor the attention span for. So I realized real quickly I'd made a mistake and started trying to figure out exit plans to get out of the whole thing.
Now, you mentioned something, right time, right place. How
yes.
important is that?
Oh, I think it's more and more I've come to realize how critically important it is. At the time, you know, I did not have that level of, as a 26-year-old young man, I didn't have that level of discernment yet to understand how what a right time and place I was in and to seize, you know, the opportunity that was there. I think it is critical. I still to this day, when I find myself in smaller ways, but when I find myself with momentum in any area and it's right time, right place, I tend to seize that and roll with it. Everything from business to relationships, friendships, but also even things as small as, for instance, this year, health you know, we all start out our first of every year, you know, making all these resolutions and things like that. And heavens knows I'd made them for years and years. The beginning of this year, I'd seen a number on a scale I never wanted to see in my lifetime. And so I quickly decided to lose a few pounds. I had the good fortune of getting, pneumonia right around then. And so when I came out the other side, I'd lost about 15, 20 pounds. So I figured right time, right place, let's seize this and go with the wind at our backs. And so I've seized that even in that this year.
Yeah, great job in that area, by the way. Yeah. You look absolutely amazing.
Thanks. I'm right about 100 pounds from the heaviest I ever was.
Oh, so. Man.
Yeah.
So I got to ask, how'd you do it?
For me, the secret worked out to be, it seemed, measurement, daily measurement. So for years, I'd been trying the methodology that I'd heard about from trainers and others of, you know, only weigh yourself once every month or go how your clothes fit and things like that. I turned that upside down and I started on a daily basis using a series of products, you know, a fit tracker type watch that tracks everything from my sleep patterns and numbers of steps and heart rate and all that good stuff to a smart scale as well that's hooked in with it where I down to the, you know, tenth of a pound, weigh myself every single morning, kind of going against what I've been taught for years. And what I found, it was almost like an unconscious temperature gauge that would cause me to just make different decisions unconsciously without even having to think about it. And everything just seemed to kind of come together and go in the right direction based on that constant measurement. I'm a big fan of that.
Yeah, me too. That's how I did it as well. And then I posted the results online and said, this is where I am. This is where I'm going.
I remember.
Yeah. So important. And look, it's like running a business, right? I mean, if you're running a business and you're not looking at the numbers, you're just guessing.
Yep.
And so many people do that.
I remember one of my first day planner trainings back in the late 80s, you know, where performance is measured, performance tends to improve. And this is just a good example of that.
You know, you touched on momentum, and I'm a big, big proponent. When things are going great, that's the time where you step on the gas. That's when you spend more time. And then when it cools off, you know, fine, retrench. But, you know, you make a big sale. And then what do most people do, right? They run off and they go, hey, let's celebrate. And they lose all that momentum. What do you do to keep that momentum going?
Well, I think A, recognizing it. B, just as you said, realizing what your pattern is, you know, as you said, when success happens for people, sometimes we tend to party, as a friend of mine always says, and then when we fail, we tend to ponder. So you kind of seizing upon, wow, when I have something great go like that, let's keep the foot down on the gas, as you said, let's keep rocking and rolling. And so knowing that about yourself, self-awareness, I think, is first and foremost the key to that. And then also accountability, as you mentioned, accountability to others also plays a big part during times like that, I think. In other words, you know, making a public commitment to do something before you have a chance to lay back and party very much. And you've got to then start the momentum all over again, which, as you and I both know, I mean, that's one of the most difficult things we can do in business, is have that momentum die off and start from ground zero or below in some cases. And so I think with age certainly comes hopefully a knowledge of that in people's professional lives. And so it just kind of bleeds over to every area.
You know, I want to talk a little bit. You and I have worked together. I've trained under you. And, yep. You know, it's fascinating. When you get to the point where you are going to close the sale, you said something very interesting when you and I were discussing. You said, look, Thor, I need you to make a decision. I don't care which way, if it's yes or if it's no, but I need you to make a decision. And when you make that decision, that it's a firm commitment that you're willing to move forward or you're not willing to move forward. Let's not leave this thing in limbo.
Yeah,
you're very good at drawing attention and bringing things to a head.
Yes. Yeah. One of the things I usually say, and I probably said this to you, I can't recall, but I probably said, you know, I'm a big boy. If the answer is no, Joe, it's not a fit for us to work together, that's fine. I can handle that. And all I ask is that we just have that level of clarity to start off our relationship working together. And so if the answer is no, it's not a good time, this is not a good fit, whatever the case may be, just say it and no problems and move ahead. I find that, you know, for a lot of people, especially in the arena of marketing, more importantly, sales, where you get down to a selling situation where, you know, as it's historically known, we're going to close the sale. We're going to start the long-term relationship, however you want to look at it. You know, people get scared of hearing a no. I like to put that ball firmly back in the court of the person that I'm creating a relationship with and let them know that is an important aspect of our working together. You have the right to say no. And if that's truthfully the answer, then that's great. I can handle that. I don't think that trying to, you know, all the old school techniques of get them saying yes over and over again, yes, 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 and then they leave no room for anything else. And as you and I both know, what that ends up in most cases resulting in is the person that I'm possibly going to be working with saying, well, let me think about it, or let me talk to my boss or my spouse or whoever it might be they need to talk to. And it's not that this method completely gets around some of that. If a person says that to me, I simply say, great, great, great. When should we check back? Is, you know, 24 hours enough time? Because, as you know, if you really need to check with someone else, I can appreciate that. I can understand that. Let's just go ahead and set a point in which we're going to come back together for a final decision.
Well, you do an amazing job there. And I think the people listening, you know, check in and see what your style. And again, it's got to be authentic. And when you do it, it's absolutely authentic.
Yeah. 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 Well, I think we live in an age of transparency and seamlessness where a lot of the old school tactics in certainly business to consumer sales, business to business sales and so forth, a lot of old walls and paradigms are being ripped down. And so I love being on the forefront of a lot of that. You know, I tend to violate a lot of the old school rules around those things. And by the way, when I do, I call that out. I point out to the potential person that I'm working with, that is not me. For instance, I'm not going to claim some false scarcity here, that there's the only one of these we've got on the lot. So, you know, put some money down on it today before you leave. You know, all of those things that have been so used and abused. Now, if there really is some reason for an opportunity to be limited in time or amount or scarcity of some kind that is true, then that absolutely should be talked about. But it should be pointed out that it is 100% integrity and truthful in there being a limited opportunity for something.
You know, this right place, right time. We could do an entire segment just on this. This will be interesting. I promise we'll move off this. But, you know, the people that we surround ourselves, we always hear, you know, the people we surround ourselves, we're the average of the five people we spend time with. One of the things I really spent a lot of time last year in doing is spending time with some badass people. Matter of fact, I have your badass little plaque back here. It says, be badass every day.
Yep.
Thank you for that.
Yeah.
And it's kind of funny, when I do a video, it's actually in the background. So
Right. Yeah, a lot of us have those.
Yeah,
huh?
you got to put a little, like, you know, sticker on there if it says Joe Williams.
Yeah, I never planned on being in the swag business.
That's right.
You know, mugs that people want and wall hangings and stuff like that. But we give that to our clients.
So reason for mentioning this is last year I really made a concerted effort. As a matter of fact, I came up with a spreadsheet, and it's by 125. So 120 and then 5. It's the 100 people that I want to spend and nurture those relationships. The 20 is a circle of friends, associates, business associates that I want to spend more time nurturing. And then the 5 are the ones that I really want to nurture. Now, I have one for business and I have one personally as well. And as I've done this and I've spent more time, I had the opportunity to spend some time with some billionaires this year. I've had the opportunity to take on some clients that are just mega, thank you, successful and wealthy. And it's funny, well, it's not funny, but the opportunities that are coming to me now, you know, instead of being, you know, thousands, I now have opportunities coming to me that have millions attached to it.
Yes.
And it's simply, there's only one answer. It's the people that I'm spending time with. If you get around people that are used to doing billion-dollar deals, there might just be a couple million-dollar deals that they want to throw your way.
Yep.
Talk about that, because you had the opportunity to spend your list of friends and acquaintances that you call close allies is amazing. What has it meant to you?
Well, you know, first of all, mindset, beliefs, the way in which people at these levels play the game differently than even successful people in many fields. And I just find that they, you know, that's getting more and more and more commonplace. You know, as we're recording this, some things are coming out around, you know, some of the biggest or, you know, most wealthy people, for instance, in the U.S., and, you know, Bezos is right up there, as usual. And yet at the same time, in the article that I was reading about him, you know, it talked about his physical transformation, over the last few years and how it's, spread over into him being, like, you know, hulked out, you know, in really, really great physical condition as well. I don't mean to harp on that, but it's something that I'm kind of obviously I'm catching around the edges because I made it so important as well as you did. And so I think that, you know, not only does the business savvy and the financial genius and so forth of playing with people who play the game a bit bigger than I do right now, that rubs off. But I think there's also all sorts of other arenas in which it can wash off in a positive or a negative way. You've got to watch out for both. And so, I've definitely, through all my time and certainly certain people that have been friends of friends and things like that, I've seen it go both ways. So being very vigilant and aware of, hey, I may want to model a person, I may want to use them as a role model in one arena of life, but not in another, is also an important thing to take a look at and be very honest with yourself about what you're looking to do, because, you know, sometimes people do fall in with the wrong crowd on, you know, 9/10 of their decisions, and then 1/10 is what attracted them to them. Maybe very wealthy, yet there may be some other things that I may not want to pick up. So
yes,
being real conscious of all of that, obviously. I also find that throughout my life, one of the big things to bring to those relationships, this is obvious, but it's worth mentioning, is making the friendship, the acquaintanceship, whatever it might be, a safe space for people like that, because many times they are so used to having people want things from them. I can think of a few of my friends right now that's a constant with them. And so they are very guarded personally, and having a way in which you can, you know, interact as peers where they know they are safe, you don't want something from them. Certainly you can learn from them, as I've done certain friends of mine from afar in a way. And then other times it's been direct conversations, you know, where we talk about things and we learn from each other in the process. But making that safe, sacred space as well, I think, is an important part of it.
It's absolutely, I think, key. I think of the relationships that I've been able to develop and it's all about what can I add.
Yeah,
what can absolutely. I add? That's how you want to know how you break into the next group, whatever that is. Figure out what you can add.
And absolutely.
Do not ask for anything in return. You know, it's funny. I've got a good buddy of mine that went to Harvard Business School, and we were talking the other day, and I said, why Harvard? And he said, you know, you could get training anywhere. He goes, the people.
Yeah.
The people that were in my class are just badasses.
Yep.
I went there because, and he does. He now has a network all over the world that he can call upon because they're buds because they went to school together.
Yeah, absolutely.
And on the fitness, I just want to point out, the reason I talk about the fitness so much is because if you're the smartest person in the room and you have brilliant ideas and you're not physically fit in order to work a 12-hour day and do the extra things that are necessary and you got to take a nap every 3 hours, you're not going to be able to execute at the highest level.
Yes.
So it's just you need the body to do that. The wrong crowd. Which I thought was interesting. The wrong crowd can actually even be just a good crowd. You know, they're just not doing or playing at the same level as you. You'll find yourself, and that's what I found. You know, not this year, but the 2-3 years ago, is I had a good peer group, but they weren't really going or doing. They were good, and I just kind of got stuck there because it was comfortable, and I love them, I enjoy them, but I realize that it was difficult for me to aspire to get to the next level and not make some changes in the group.
Yes. Yeah. I think, you know, it's important to stay aware and acute to those times, for sure. And then, you know, there's tough decisions to be made, especially when occasionally it's lifelong friends or even family members. One thing that I think I probably got it originally from my parents, from my father specifically, in that he was fairly, I remember at the time growing up, fairly what I would call ruthless now and in hindsight about cutting certain people out of his life. And he was one of the people who role modeled for me making the tough decisions around family members. And it is tough. There's no doubt about it. Yet many times it's for the ultimate best of everybody involved to certainly limit, your exposure to lifelong friends, family members, and so forth, to not let that association just go unchecked.
Yeah. And, you know, the other distinction that I discovered, I don't know, probably in the last 90 days is the very successful, and define it any way that you want to, whether it's money or fitness or love, relationship, whatever it is.
Yeah.
You mentioned it. They play the game differently. And this just made itself so clear to me, is most people, including myself, was playing the game of add one. It was a linear progression.
Yeah.
They don't do that. They play at a level where they're making massive steps.
Yes.
It's a quantum leap. And it's funny, the more time I spend around people that are really, really executing at the highest level and getting results that, you know, as the 1% of a 1% of a 1%, is they look at things differently. They don't play fair. They don't play the same game that most people are playing. Thank you so much for listening today. I really do appreciate your time. And I hope you found today's show valuable. If you would like to receive these shows automatically to your phone or to your computer, simply go to iTunes and subscribe. After listening to several of the shows, if you're so inclined, please leave us a 5-star rating, as this helps us reach additional people and spread the message. If you're truly committed to taking your life to the next level and doing whatever it takes to become a peak performer, but something's holding you back, something is blocking your way, and you just can't seem to figure out what it is, send me an email to info@thorconklin.com, and I'd be more than happy to get on the phone with you. We'll schedule a 15-minute discovery call. No obligation, no cost. I absolutely love to hear from the listeners, and if there's something I can do to help, I'd be more than happy to do that. Also, if you found something of great interest in today's show and you want to share that with your friends and family, simply go to my Facebook page, Thor Conklin. Click on the episode, hit the share button, and share it on your page. You can follow me at Twitter @ThorConklin. The website is ThorConklin.com. We're constantly adding new free resources discussing additional tricks, tips, tools, and strategies on how to be a peak performer. Remember, I try to keep these episodes short so you can listen to them during dot time, doing other things, commuting, driving, walking, working out. Decide to be a peak performer in all that you do. And until tomorrow, have an absolutely amazing day.
Be on the lookout for part two of our conversation with Joe, where he tells us why stage fright is actually a good thing for public speakers, as well as why volunteering can be your ticket to landing the job you want. I'll see you guys on another edition of Peak Performers Podcast.